Good morning, Joe.
How are you today?
I'm doing just fine, thank you.
In the dog days of August here.
Yes, indeed.
But the weather cooperated for your golf tournament yesterday.
Yeah, we were very fortunate. We have a good weather service that we deal with, and they told us you should get it in. There'd be some showers late in the day, and that's exactly what happened. Although I wasn't expecting late last night some of the downpours that we did have, but thankfully everything worked out well citywide. Yeah. Flooding issues, but nothing major.
Where was the tournament, and what was it for?
Each year we hold the Mayor's Cup. It's been going on for, gosh, a long time now. It used to be the President's Golf Course when Jim Sheets was mayor. And so up at Quarry Hills each year, and we have a number of sponsors and players. And, you know, the money we raise, some of it helps us with the parades, Christmas and Flag Day, and some of it helps us with charity work that we do in the community, you know, things that government can't necessarily do when people are in need or certain organizations are in need. It really comes in handy. It goes to the Quincy Foundation, and I think it's a 501c4. It does a lot of good in the community, so I'm grateful for everybody. And I actually golfed yesterday. I haven't done that in years at that tournament because I'm not that fond of the game, and the game's not that fond of me. So generally, don't golf, but we had a good time. It was a lot of fun.
And do you want to reveal your score? Or?
Well, it's best ball tournament. So.
Oh, okay.
You can't screw up too badly with a best ball tournament, but okay. I did my best.
about how much you raised?
About $110,000.
That's amazing. That's great.
Yeah, super. It's a great day.
Very nice. Speaking of the flooding, Mayor, I know that the city was prepared over the weekend in the event Henri was more serious. The emergency operations center, I guess, was open. Is that right?
Yeah, we had everything ready to go. Yeah. Allie does a great job of the emergency management aspect, and of course Dave Murphy and the gang from Natural Resources were prepared with the tree stuff, and Al Grazioso and his crew of Public Works manage all the tide gate systems and pumps for floodings and so forth. So everyone was prepared, but thankfully it went the other direction, and yes, we didn't have to deal with a lot of the problems some communities dealt with, you know.
Right. Yeah, the hurricane season just getting going, though, so I'm sure you'll be on alert throughout the next couple of months.
Yeah, we'll certainly keep an eye on things.
Sure.
But again, we have great departments, and they're right on top of things. People forget that, you know, if you were building Quincy today, you probably wouldn't be building on at least a third of it because it was filled in marshland and so forth. So there's a lot of natural areas that would tend to get wet, and we've got dozens and dozens of tide gates around the city that we manage, and some real major ones like the gates at the Greenberg Bridge on Quincy Shore Drive. And if you don't keep up with those things, then we could have some real major issues. And as we go forward with the sea level rise, it's only going to become more of a challenge. So we continue to monitor things. We continue to improve things, our systems. As you know, we're doing a lot of work on seawalls. So, you know, just keep chipping away at it.
Yeah. Speaking of natural resources, I know there's a neighborhood meeting tonight about the future of the former Beachcomber location. Could you maybe explain a little bit about the plans for a park there?
Yeah, it's pretty much going to be a passive park is what we decided, Joe. That's another example. You know, the building proposal that was on that site was meeting real challenges with state engineers. And, you know, again, that you go back in that back section, the Beachcomber and the Strand area, you know, it's pretty low level. And we've got major pump stations there just to pump the storage and stuff out because it's so low-lying. And so we felt it best to take it for open space. Let's not add to the burden in a neighborhood like that. And then, of course, it's a beautiful stretch along Quincy Shore Drive, so we just want to embellish that and not really add any major attraction that would be a problem and to maintain as well. I think a beautiful passive area that, you know, people could walk through and perhaps sit under a tree or whatever, but no major plans. I mean, it's not big enough for any athletic uses and so forth. So I think it just, it's one of those places where I just think it calls for clean it up, regrade it, plant some trees, and shrubs. Don't overplant it because you don't want to ruin people's views of the water, but certainly enough to add to the beauty of that stretch we have along Quincy Shore Drive.
I know you had mentioned a little while ago about maybe putting a statue there or a monument to sailors.
Yeah, that was one of the locations that we looked at, but I think we've shifted gears on that.
Oh, okay.
it appears that the way we're going, Marina Bay is, we're kind of zeroed in on. Marina Bay has quite a history of shipbuilding as well as a naval air station. Mm-hmm. So, and it's some beautiful spots down there, I think, that would people be able to get out and enjoy. And I think the concern was that the site of the Beachcoma would be a more of a drive-by. People couldn't really get out and enjoy the area, the statue, get pictures and so forth. So I think Marina Bay is probably going to be the choice, and we're working now on that.
Okay, very good. Can we talk a little bit, Mayor, about your reaction to the federal census numbers that were released recently when it comes to the city?
Yeah, we're still waiting for some more information, but, you know, the press learned before I did what the number was. We got a call on that last week, and I was surprised at its number. I knew it would be over 100,000. I think we've talked a little bit about this, working with City Clerk Nikki Crispo and former City Clerk Joe Shea. We were all in the consensus that we thought would be in the 105 to 110 range. Then in the spring, the Donahue Institute out of UMass did an analysis statewide, and they pegged us at a little over 106. So I thought, okay, that's right where we thought we'd be. And then the number came out at 101.6, which was a little lower than we thought, but that is the number. I don't know if we're going to go anything further with the appeals process. So I had a conversation with the city clerk the other day about looking at the census blocks to see if they're fairly accurate. We do know where the growth was, so if we think that they missed some things, then we're certainly going to appeal it.
Oh, okay.
But it's not a case of trying to hit a goal of a number. It's really the goal is to get everybody counted so that we get the resources from the federal government that we deserve. Mm-hmm. That's really what it comes down to. So we'll keep monitoring it. So it's since the last federal census count, it's up about 9,000. You know, older cities like Quincy, we have a heavy immigration population. It gets difficult to get everybody counted. So it's always a challenge. And, you know, we'll see where we're at. But that is the number for now. You know, it may get adjusted a little bit upward, but mm-hmm. I don't see a major change in it.
Would that make a difference in grant money, the extra 5,000 people?
It does make a difference in numbers. It makes a difference two ways. One is once you go over 100,000, you treat it a little differently from the federal government. From the scrutiny aspect, mm-hmm. and EPA and all those agencies, a little tougher. The flip side is you become more eligible for grant monies and federal dollars. So we're always chasing federal and state monies to help us, with all kinds of infrastructure issues in our cities. We'll continue to do that.
Mayor, it's getting close to back-to-school time. Can we talk a little bit about the decision by the school committee to kind of keep the mask mandate in place for right now?
Yes, that was a tough decision, but when you really analyze the rules and regulations set down by the State Department of Education, it all but said wear masks. Mm-hmm. And for example, if kids did not have masks on and somebody got tested positive, for example, in a classroom with COVID, the whole class would have had to be quarantined. Mm. Now, if you start to add that up around, and even if the kids aren't sick, it's just the rule, if somebody tests positive, everybody in the classroom would have had to be quarantined. So now all of a sudden you're talking about a lot of kids missing school again. So that's one example. There are a number of examples, but we felt, you know, at this point, let's just keep it in place. In fact, I would suggest before the week is out, the state comes out with a tougher mandate on and just come out and saying it, just for the kids who wear the mask, at least through a portion of the fall.
Right.
Now, I know I've taken a lot of emails and phone calls on this issue, and from both extremes, there are folks that I think we should be wearing masks for the rest of our lives, and there's folks that think that this is all crazy, we don't need to wear masks, they don't do anything. Somebody said it's like keeping mosquitoes out with a chain link fence. Well, you know, we try to find, you know, really policy-wise, we try to find ourselves a little bit in the middle there, trying to follow some of the census. I mean, some of the consensus of the CDC and the state public health. But at the end of the day, when the State Department of Education issues certain regulations, we have to follow them.
Yeah.
So we do that. The flip side is I am not imposing a indoor mask requirement for venues and restaurants. And, so I know some cities have done that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's necessary. It's the last number I saw, Joe, is 0.2% of people that have been vaccinated were testing positive, so that means 99.8% are doing just fine.
Right.
on the vaccination side. So, I think sometimes we get caught up in the national news, and there's some real issues in a lot of states, but Massachusetts is doing very well. We have a little uptick, yes, but I don't think it's time to hit the panic button.
Finally, Mayor, brand new City of Quincy Welcome Center opens today.
Yeah, today's a busy day, Joe.
Yeah.
I'm going down the shipyard at 9 o'clock to see the new Engine 2, which has arrived.
Oh, okay.
The newest piece of apparatus for our city. 10 o'clock, I have a orientation with school principals, particularly the new principals. We'll be going to welcome them and talking about the upcoming school year and the importance of the principal in a building. They really set the tone in a building.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a very important role. I think sometimes it's underestimated, the importance of it. And then at 11:30, we're opening the Welcoming Center. Yes, so the building next door, the old Grand Asia dress shop space, we have purchased that building with federal money, as you know. There's people that have strong feelings about that either way. But we felt we'd put it to some good use. That corner there is a very high traffic pedestrian corner and be able to capture a lot of people. So obviously our tourism director, Dagny, and Rob Damon, our heritage director, have been working hard on this with our city departments to get this opened up, providing tours each day to the town hall, to the cemetery, working with the church on the crypts. As you know, the Park Service doesn't look like they're going to open this year at all.
I know.
And so there's a lot of folks that come through here looking for some type of experience related to our history and the Adams story. So I think this will fill the bill for a period of time, and we'll continue to work at it. As you know, we use some of the hotel tax money to pay for programs like this. So it's a great opportunity. We need to do this. We sell ourselves as a community with rich history, which we are. So we've got to be prepared for that and do the right thing when it comes to visitation. And I think this is a great program that people will enjoy.
So did the purchase of the building has been completed?
Purchase of the building has been completed. And City of Quincy now owns that building.
Okay.
And we are now going through, literally through the whole building and assessing where we're at, structure-wise, where we are with all the businesses that are in there. Some have moved on,
mm-hmm.
And some will be looking to move on at some point. We are going to go through a very, very good process, I think, that will have a lot of community involvement over the next 6 months to a year in determining the future use, which I still believe it has great potential for a new college building, and we'll look at that, as well as dealing with our tourism programs like this, and perhaps deal with the problem glass building of City Hall for future use as well. So we'll go through that. We'll have a good committee together, work with the City Council, as well as other community partners, and then we'll go from there.
Okay. A lot going on, so I won't keep you, Mayor. You've got places to be and things to do.
Busy day, but it's all good. It's all positive.
Yeah, I should congratulate you quickly on your appointment to the new T Board of Directors.
Well, thank you, I think. I appreciate really the confidence of my colleagues. T is an important entity in the state and certainly an important entity for the City of Quincy. And I don't take this on for any personal gain. I take this on because the T needs attention, needs people to weigh in, needs people to hold people accountable. And quite frankly, I think it's going to be good for the City of Quincy. This will allow me to use that position to make sure that our projects like Quincy Center Rehab and Rebuild, whatever it may be in the end, get taken care of. So it'll be interesting and hopefully some fun as well.
Thanks again, Mayor.
Thanks, Joe.
Bye-bye.